back in the 60s, we were desperate, you know, our generation, and I include myself with Elton in that. Music was the thing that was pulling us out of this post-war, you know, sort of poverty, you know, grayness. And music was actually the thing that we grabbed onto, and it became our passion.
I was a friend in Liverpool, from where I came, with Brian Epstein, the first manager of the Beatles. And he asked me to come and help him in the administration of the management of the Beatles. And after he died, a few years later, I went to work for a man called Dick James, whose company published the works of Lennon and McCartney, and of a lot of other people. And one of the chaps that he, whose music he published, was a nice, pleasant, respectful young man called Reginald Dwight, who later on changed his name to Elton John.
I would have run into him in the Dick James Music Studio publishing office, which would have been in New Oxford Street at the time, above the Midland Bank in New Oxford Street. Dick James Music had their offices, and Elton, or Reg as everybody called him at the time, was a staff writer, really, along with other people like Philip Goodhand Tate, people that, you know, weren't necessarily stars or even songwriters in the public eye. They would have been people that were writing for the catalogue of Dick James Music.
Elton would come in every week for his weekly advance, I was going to say handout, was advance. It started at about £10 a week, I think, and later on was increased to £15 a week. And I was not only aware of him, but we used to say hello and chat a little, and he was very pleasant. And I formed a good impression of him. I was not particularly aware of his music at that time, because it wasn't part of my job to listen to music or to go to gigs.
We're talking about 1969. You know, that's the year that I first started working there. And Elton had Empty Sky out, and was obviously a songwriter that Dick James Music and Dick James Records were pushing. I don't think they got very far at the time.
Empty Sky was his debut album, and he hadn't built up enough of a fan base at this stage to obviously, you know, have the massive sales he had later on. It was pretty much a calling card for Elton John and an indication of the style of balladeer that he was.
I think the reason why Empty Sky, Elton's first album, bombed is that on every score, it was colossally awful. Had one of the worst sleeves ever to adorn a piece of music. I mean, a picture of Elton looking like an absolute book. It said, don't buy this, it's rubbish. On the strength of that album, it's a bloody miracle that Elton John went on to make another record, let alone have this kind of long and lucrative career that he's had.
The Elton John album, which was the second album, in fact, the eponymous album, was his first massive hit in the States, really. He was huge in the States before he was huge in the UK, really. And Your Song was obviously, you know, led to that, as a hit single does. It still somehow isn't as well known or as legendary as some of his later albums, but it did. It was a huge hit, and it's just perhaps that the albums after that, the next six or seven, were so implausibly huge that one tends to be overlooked. But Elton John diehard fans really do rate it, even if the general music listener doesn't really go back to it that often.
I think with the 1970 Elton John album, I think you've pretty much kind of got the blueprint for what Elton albums were going to be like in throughout the 70s. You've got kind of you've got your kind of piano-led rockers, you know, side by side with your kind of almost schmaltzy kind of ballads, you know, but kind of in a kind of blue-eyed soul kind of way. And I think it's interesting as an album because you could say, well, it almost kind of, without quite fulfilling itself, it kind of defined the Elton John style, what you could expect from an Elton John album.
I think that album really sort of sets the benchmark. You know, they wrote the new songs, they got enough songs for Empty Sky, and Steve said, well, I'll produce it. Because there wasn't anybody else. I mean, there wasn't Big Bucks, and it was, you know, I think it was DJ M Studio, so he produced it, and that's got the flavour. But they, in doing that album, I think they realised what they couldn't do on their own. And then when Gus Dudgeon came into the picture, you know, Gus was a very, very confident man. And I mean, he went on to produce a lot of my stuff, and he was just so great in the studio because he had a million stories. And I'm sure that confidence would have been great for Elton, you know, to sit in the studio, not to have to make the decisions for somebody who's had a hit. You know, he's had the David Bowie thing going on, and they spent a lot of money on that record. You know, I think Dick James needed to be credited with taking the risk, you know, because the previous album hadn't done a lot. But they put that orchestra together, Paul Buckmaster, the whole thing, and it just, you know, from there on in, I mean, it could have been a disaster, couldn't it? That's the bottom line. It could have been a disaster, but it wasn't. You know, the fates had it that was going to be the hit record that launched it.
And you can tell everybody this is your song. It may have been quite simple, but now that it's done, hope you don't mind. I hope you don't mind that I put down the word. How wonderful life is for your endure.
Coming into a world of pop music in 1970, where most things are guitar-based. So everything's around the guitar chords, whether it's in E, or whether it's in C, because most piano players like C. But nobody went for the in-between keys. Now, Elton has this style of going for the in-between keys because it suits his hands. If you think 1970, you're listening to the radio and you're listening to all these songs roughly in the same keys, and you will finish, the previous pop song might finish in a nice E major. And then the next single comes on. It's a completely different key to everything else that you're hearing during the day. And it's almost like a breath of fresh air. He's playing in keys that most people don't want to go near because there's too many sharps and flats. It's too fiddly and too complicated. And it has the effect of making it stand out amongst the other records that are around at the time.
Your song was the Elton John first hit, really, in this country. It was what made his name known outside sort of musician circles in this country. It gave him a big top three hit. It is a durable ballad. It's a very memorable melody. The words affected a lot of people. They're very sensitive, very individual. This is Bernie Taupin, the lyricist, who perhaps doesn't always get the credit that Elton John gets. He obviously wrote those lyrics, as he wrote all the lyrics. But it's a good song, although there are some very clumsy lines, some very sort of lines that don't quite make sense, that don't bear analysis if you really put them under the microscope.
It's the one Elton John song that I find completely irresistible. It's just got this beautiful lilted melody. I'm not a great fan of Elton's voice. I think, you know, in kind of, you know, rock and roll terms, you know, he was burdened with an unpretty instrument of a voice. But it somehow sounds quite magnificent on your song.
Like many other writers, that could have been a one-hit wonder thing. You wouldn't have known at the time that he was going to go on to make his name as a world star. And I think it's his live persona that did that, more than his pure talent as a songwriter.
How wonderful life is.
began, of course, you know, session work, working with John Mayall's bluesology, and he'd introduced himself on his first album, arguably the second, as just an ordinary guy who was celebrating his ordinariness, you know, just Reg Dwight, you know, he was just a good old guy playing piano in pubs. Pretty soon that accelerated and went completely the other way. When glam rock happened, he jumped on the bandwagon of glam rock. He saw what Bowie was doing, Ziggy Stardust, T-Rex, Slade, Sweet, Mudd, everybody was doing it, so he kind of, like Rod Stewart, he sort of jumped on that bandwagon and started coming across in massive platform boots as a sort of over-the-top mad Liberace. And his stage shows became increasingly a part of what he was about. So it's as if Elton Hercules John became this alter ego that Reg Dwight turned into more and more as the 70s went on.
But as soon as he started going to America, 1970, we're a long way away from the duck costumes and the giant glasses and the huge platform boots, but it would be gold lamé suits, lots of colour, you know, lots of vibrant colours. This from a man who, as we all know, you know, deeply shy, deeply flawed, deeply introverted, not a natural performer. And I think, but he was a man who by 71, 72 quite clearly lived to be on stage. I mean, you know, he was a man who really didn't know how to live, you know, in the real world. Hadn't yet discovered the drink, the drugs, and the shopping and all the rest of the addictions. And so the stage for him became this incredible outlet for the Elton John that he created.
I think he fits along with several other English musician, songwriter, composers, insofar as they were quintessentially English, yet they were passionate about American music. I mean, for instance, Tumbleweed Connection shows his enormous influence of the band, for instance, and the Basement Tapes, the Bob Dylan and the band Basement Tapes. We were all incredibly overawed by that record, or those records, and they influenced all of us. And if you listen to Tumbleweed Connection, you can hear the influence, like, very easily.
I think it's one of Elton's, you know, strongest collections of songs, and I think it's, once again, it kind of edged Elton John forward in terms of an idea that I think you could almost say that he became his own genre, that no one was quite like Elton John. Elton John wasn't quite like anyone else. That it was almost like Elton John was almost a category in itself, and I think that was really starting to happen with an album like Tumbleweed.
I wasn't really in the States on the West Coast when he was doing his sellout shows, and he did that live album, which really, you know, sort of the whole thing just took off completely at that point, you know. And but before that, obviously, everybody knew that he was a class act, but he wasn't. It hadn't become a superstar. I got a call about 10 p.m. one evening, and they just wanted me to come down to Trident Studios straight away, basically. And so I jumped in the car with all my equipment, got to Trident Studios about midnight, and everybody was there. The basic track was laid down with everybody except the strings. And we just worked through the night, putting the arrangement together. And we came out about 6 a.m. when the light was coming up, and felt great because we just like cut something that was very, we felt at the time, it was a very important session. That for Tiny Dancer. Blue jean baby, L.A. lady,
seamstress for the band. And Madman Across the Water again has heavy strings and a big, goes for a big epic sound, but the songs, he's really learning his craft now. He's not just sort of hacking out the sort of pop for supermarkets that he used to do, you know, before he was a solo artist. He's getting his own sound. His singing is decent, you know, tends to be overlooked that he was actually a decent singer at this time. And of course, he's got the one of the best songs he ever wrote, which is Tiny Dancer. And now she's in me, always with me.
At the time, it seemed quite a left-field, quirky idea for a song. And you thought, yeah, that's great. It's a great idea, but, you know, I can't see it as being a sort of a hit or a long-term classic, because it was a bit left-field. But then that's qualified by my feelings that you at the time, you just weren't aware of his future stature. You know, how can you say that something's going to be such a classic when you don't even know that the artist is going to become probably one of the most important singer-songwriters in the history of popular music?
Deny that it's quintessential Elton John. It's kind of got, you know, the melody is pure Elton. The fact that it's kind of, it overreaches itself in the sense that it really it's a song in kind of almost like four separate movements. It's one of the first Elton John songs where he sings in what might be described as a faintly annoying transatlantic accent. Something was creeping into his voice. Actually, he spent a lot of time in America at the time, and that was clearly having an influence. But now, as a song, I mean, it's kind of, to me, it's Your Song light in the sense that it kind of takes the best of Your Song in terms of, you know, the melody and the mood, and just extends itself. It seems to go on forever.
At the time, people are releasing singles which are 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes, 3 minutes, maybe. Along comes Elton with a song in excess of 6 minutes. You can talk about Bohemian Rhapsody being great because it was so long, but that's years and years later. You know, kudos to the man. It's brilliant. And it doesn't suffer for it. It's not boring. There's production techniques which help it along, but the essence of the song is it holds your attention all the way through. There are builds in the production where the entry of the different instruments at different times has a nice progression. The choir coming in is fantastic. But it's a superb song, and it just holds your attention for 6 minutes. Fantastic. Unheard of, really, in those days.
I think what the whole of Madman Across the Water represented and that era of Elton John had a very important feel to it and represented something not only in this country but also in Los Angeles, and where Elton was held in the highest esteem. And he was creating history, really, musical history. And I think Tiny Dancer was the track that was the easiest track on that album to take on board, because there's no real hits on that album. There's no singles on that album. And Tiny Dancer was the closest that any of the tracks were to being a hit on that record. Being an English sensibility, synthesizing the influence of American music, gospel, Ray Charles, country, jazz, the blues, everything. It's all in there. And he loves country music, which is hence the influence of the pedal steel, of course. He wants to put it all in there, but he doesn't want it to be American. And I think, coming back to that subject, he's, you know, the great English synthesizer of American musical styles, or one of them, you know.
I mean, Honky Chateau gave Elton, you know, his first number one album. One of the big reasons for that was because it was preceded by the single Rocket Man, you know, one of Elton's, you know, biggest hits.
She packed my bags last night. Zero out of 9 a.m.
I think it benefits from This is partly due to the production, but I think also due to the songs, in that he brought in a kind of lighter touch. Madman Across the Water had kind of plodded. It was a point where Elton had got kind of stuck in the mud, if you like. I mean, I think with this, there's incredible variety. You've got your ballads, your rockers, you know, you've got some country rock in there. You've got, of course, you know, Rocket Man itself. But I think it's an album that it's got depth as well as breadth, and I think that's what makes it work. I think it's accomplished, and I think Elton was really at this point beginning to find his own voice.
And nothing's gonna be a long time. No touchdown breaks where I don't get too fine. I'm not the man that big time I come. No. I'm a rocket man.
Honky Chateau is where he starts to sound like the 70s Elton John that most of us remember. You know, little elements of glam rock and things coming in. A track called Honky Cat, where he tries out black R&B. And he was sort of beginning to hang out with the other British superstars of the time. He knew the Rolling Stones and Jagger, he knew Bowie. These were all people that worked at the Chateau Hérouville, where he went to record this album with his band. A lot of people around this time were going to the Chateau. It was in a part of France where you're kind of miles from anywhere, and a lot of bands were finding that it was good to go there because you were away from temptation. You had to record. There wasn't much of a, you weren't in a town where you could go out partying. Wasn't much else to do. It was very nice grounds. But although some said it was haunted, but you're pretty much in the chateau with the studio, and you're pretty much there for the, you know, for the couple of weeks you were there.
Bars ain't the kind of place to raise your kid. In fact, it's cold as hell. But there's no one there to raise him.
It's easy to dismiss a song like Rocket Man as kind of, you know, Elton John's, you know, riposte to Bowie's Space Oddity or whatever. It's kind of more than that. I think this is one of Bernie Taupin's cleverest lyrics. He's almost imagining the job of an astronaut to be as normal as, say, a truck driver. So he's describing an astronaut basically going out to do a job. And I think that kind of, I sometimes wish, you know, Bernie Taupin would write more like that. There's almost something quite kind of Lennon-McCartney-ish about just taking something as strange as being an astronaut and just kind of normalising it, just making it seem kind of everyday.
You've got a very basic two-chord sequence that it starts with, G minor to C. But with Elton, nothing's that straightforward. You've got a seventh on the minor. And to move to the C, the right hand is almost identical. There's just one note that moves in the middle of it. On the second verse, it's even less than that. The second verse, it actually holds the straight chord all the way through. Not your normal pop chords, that's for sure. But strange coincidence. We're talking 1972. When this was released, must have been the same time somebody else was writing the same chord sequence. Now, is it just my imagination? Is it a very strange coincidence? Elton's writing about a man going to space. Remind you of anything else? Side of the Moon is coming out about the same time. Great Gig in the Sky, it's exactly the same chords.
Mars ain't the kind of place to raise your kid. In fact, it's cold as hell.
Melodically, it's you know, very few people can resist it. Again, the lyrics are either great or terrible. there was this tendency in John and Taupin songs where you'd get a couplet and you think, that's good, and then the next couplet you'd think, that's awful, that's just there because it rhymes. And, well, you could pretty much go through the whole song, but there are good lines and bad lines that really stand out like a sore thumb. But he sings it very well, in fairness, and, you know, later on he became quite a lazy singer, but at this stage he was still putting a lot of thought and consideration into his vocals.
I always felt with Rocket Man, as much as I kind of like it, it's never a song I can love, because I feel throughout it that Elton kind of, you can almost hear Elton kind of ducking the high notes. And I think, really, if I'd written Rocket Man, I would have said, well, actually, somebody like Roberta Flack should sing this. I think it would have been a perfect song for somebody with a vocal range like that, because Elton does go high on that song, but it's kind of, he can't quite manage it. It's kind of out of his focus. It's beyond his abilities. I think that's what kind of prevents it from being great and timeless. And I think in other hands, it needed more soulfulness than Elton could bring to it.
Don't Shoot Me was perhaps the one that really brought it home to the British consciousness, at least. It was, although his fans had bought previous albums and America had bought previous albums, and they had sold decently, this was the one that kind of really became unavoidable as a big number one of the era. You know, the early 70s had lots of classic rock landmarks, from, you know, Aladdin Sane to Dark Side of the Moon to, you know, Rod Stewart, Roxy Music, Led Zeppelin. You know, the early 70s was a very fertile period for rock. This was probably his calling card album that people really could not avoid. It was an album where he tried out various different things. He tried out nostalgia and bubblegum, as on Crocodile Rock. He kind of tried to reinvent that late 50s sound. But to be sort of revamping Chuck Berry wasn't that brave a statement in that era, where people were starting to do very different and unusual things with both glam rock and progressive rock. This was very much sort of radio-friendly, or more than radio-friendly. It was sort of mum and dad friendly. It wasn't, you know, scaring the parents like glam rock and perhaps, you know, hairy prog rock were and metal. It was harking back to something a previous generation had liked, the sort of straightforward R&B rock and roll, the Johnny B. Goode sound, the Neil Sedaka sound. You know, Neil Sedaka was one of his big heroes. And the sort of gum-snapping, bubblegum sound.
I think the incredible, you know, furiously busy schedule that Elton was maintaining, you know, in the early 70s, so finally kind of, you know, the chickens came home to roost with Don't Shoot Me, I'm Only the Piano Player in 73, were, in some quarters it's regarded as his first kind of pure pop record, but I just, you know, my feeling about it, my feeling when it came out was that it's kind of, it's almost like a pastiche of a pop record. You know, Daniel, which is obviously the standout track on the album, the one that kind of everyone remembers, it was a huge hit, is almost kind of Elton John by numbers. You know, it's kind of, it's got that sort of your song mood, and it's got a kind of, it's got a vocal which is content not to kind of challenge itself in any way or kind of do anything particularly new or particularly interesting. It's kind of, it's just, it's an Elton John sound.
As well as things like Crocodile Rock, the upbeat side, that he again showed he could write a good ballad with good mournful, if a little predictable, chords, with again enigmatic but somehow inexplicably moving, if nonsensical, lyrics by Bernie Taupin. But Daniel was again a sort of a top three hit, and is again a tune that's very hard to dislike. Even if you could, you know, there are holes in the lyrics the size of a truck, you know. it's not a flawless song. There are people who write flawless ballads, but there are Elton John ballads which are full of holes, and yet you just can't, they're like big cuddly teddy bears and you can't really kick them. It gave him, I think, more hits from one album than he'd had previously to this date, and certainly made him very much an unavoidable piece of the British pop culture fabric. Whoa, if you're my brother, you are.
My time in Elton's life, Elton's time in my life, was between Goodbye Yellow Brick Road and Captain Fantastic. It's almost bookended by both of those albums. And Goodbye Yellow Brick Road was right at the start and it was so exciting. And you know, there wasn't a bad track on the album.
Goodbye, Norma Jean. Though I never knew, well, I had the grace to hold yourself while those around you grow.
I think Goodbye Yellow Brick Road is the peak. Really. I mean, who was the guy who wrote Catch 22? Somebody said to him afterwards, you know, he never wrote anything as good as Catch 22. And he said, well, neither did anybody else, you know. And, you know, Goodbye Yellow Brick Road has got to be up there as just a seminal work, you know, the work that maybe defines Elton. That doesn't mean the rest of the stuff that's come afterwards isn't any good. It just means that's the defining moment, isn't it? That's the thing, that's the record. So many albums are going to be judged by, because it sounds fantastic. It does flow so well. It's a hit after hit after hit. And it's on a double album as well. It's not like, you know, so the chances of getting it wrong on a double album are quite high. And it doesn't seem long, you know, it doesn't seem like a long record.
If there is one Elton John album from the period which is the landmark album, you know, the calling card album, most huge bands or artists have their kind of their calling card album, this would be the one that people remember really as the biggest monument to his career at that time. As a double album, some people think it's terrific all the way through and his magnum opus. It has to be said, it could easily be pruned to a single album. You know, you've got 8 or 10 very good songs. You've got eight really duff ones there, really. There's a lot of filler. Obviously, the standouts are the big hit singles, the Goodbye Yellow Brick Road and Candle in the Wind, which are, you know, massive landmarks in pop music.
I think Elton John's pretty much admitted that what he was trying to do with the album Goodbye Yellow Brick Road was he'd been listening a lot to the Beatles' Revolver and was just in awe of the kind of the scope and the majesty of that record, and indeed, you know, it's a magisterial work. So what he did with Yellow Brick Road was kind of, he suddenly went kind of completely widescreen. I mean, it was to be a double album. It was to be over the top in all respects. I think, you know, it's an album that at points almost kind of Wagnerian in its kind of ambition, with great pop songs interspersed. I mean, essentially, I think it's really, Goodbye Yellow Brick Road brings about the real Americanization of Elton John as an artist. It's a very American album. I think it's steeped in kind of Hollywood lore. It's steeped in a kind of, in a respectful way, but a kind of real love for sort of 50s, late 50s, early 60s kind of American pop. It's got that kind of influence coming into it. I think it's one of those where you've got to ask yourself, would it have been better as a single album? And I think it's one of those where you've got to say, it just comes at you, Goodbye Yellow Brick Road, and I think it's kind of, while it's impossible to say that all the songs are great, I think as a work, as a cohesive work, I think it really, really works, and I think it marked a certain passing. It marked a point where I think Elton, this was Elton, I think, at the very peak of his 70s form. I think he had just real command. I think him and Taupin had come together in such a way that they dovetailed so neatly. as a writing team, that it was just really hard to resist. I think it's his ultimate pop record.
The great thing about Goodbye Yellow Brick Road is that Bernie has finally got his act completely together, and that every story is told so well. You know, because earlier on some of the early albums, it gets a little bit, you know, what's he on about? The great words, but it's just like, it's hard to tell. By Goodbye Yellow Brick Road, every story is told neatly, you know where it's going, and Elton's melodies just match them so well, and are so memorable. Every song is a memorable song, and they're very melodic. Even Benny and the Jets, you know, which is probably the hardest sounding song we know, which suddenly broke him in the R&B stations in America, which took, I think, everybody by surprise. It's still very melodic.
Jets is an unusual sound, and at least they're trying something different there. It's got a sort of a canned applause track, it's got a stomping backbeat, which is very unusual, and not like anything else really, which is praise. And it has a feel of a kind of an American concert, almost a little bit gospel-y, but twisting that around. And it's one of the rare times where Elton John and his band have ever tried something sonically different and sonically interesting. They've always been very conventional, very trad, very four square. You know, unlike other people of the time, Bowie, Roxy Music, they've never experimented with sound. Elton John has never really pushed the envelope. He's dabbled with different genres, but he's never, you know, played around with those genres and pushed the envelope. He's always played very safe, very conservative in that way. If there is one track from this period where he's perhaps tried something a little bit weird and offbeat, it's Benny and the Jets. It's one of those tracks that people love or hate.
If he's playing an arpeggio style arrangement like your song, broken chords, arpeggios, the other style of playing he has is the thumping chords. Now, for those things, because you're hitting them hard, he tends to go for the white keys, like your G major, which only has one black note in it, and C major, which has no black notes in it. But like Benny and the Jets, moves between G and F. And so when he's hitting hard, he tends to favour the white keys, so. So it's less chance of, you know, I mean, I've fluffed that myself, but if you were trying to get in between the black notes, he'd be real trouble. So you tend to find he goes for the more normal keys if he's going to have to do something. It's not a rule of thumb. It's just an interesting observation.
Have grown up, they've been on tour, they're match fit. You know, you can't do that many gigs all together as a band. And so they're peaking at the right time. Guess is peaking at the right time. And the string arrangements, they've got a guy called Del Newman, and the string arrangements are beautiful. They're not as extravagant or as recognizable as Paul Buckmaster, but they're just right. And everything has sort of been building up to this moment. And it's there, and it's, you know, it's what a great legacy. Thank you.
Caribou was a bit of a rush job, not as bad as some of the albums that followed it later, but it had a couple of good tracks, again, the hit singles. Every time with Elton John albums, with your eyes closed, you can say, I bet the good tracks are the ones that were the hit singles, because if you probe beyond the couple of hit singles, you're not going to find very much there at all. It was saved probably by The Bitch's Back, which was a half-decent rock track, and Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me, which was a big epic ballad, very strong, later resurrected by George Michael, obviously, and remains a kind of a standard big ballad in the same way that Hey Jude or He Ain't Heavy, He's My Brother or something, or You've Lost That Loving Feeling, a big epic ballad that is what he's best at, really.
My images really of Elton when I think of him are the picture from Caribou of the tiger skin jacket, the big glasses, you know. Because I was around at that time, you know, I remember the whole discussion, what should the album be called? Because it was recorded at a studio called Caribou in America, up in the Rockies, I think it was. And he wanted to call it Old Pink Eyes Is Back, because the glasses have got like a pink tinge on them. Steve Brown's going, oh, no, no. And I remember the acetate coming over, Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me. And I played it like 10 times in a row at Steve Brown's house. And I remember saying to him, I just love that song. He said, I know, I've heard it 10 times this morning before breakfast. So Caribou's a bit of an odd album. There's some great songs and some real songs that I love, and I can really pinpoint of where I was. But then going out to Captain Fantastic, it's the first time he sang his own story. And I think, you know, up until then it's always been Bernie's story. And so I suppose it is going to be self-indulgent in a way. But by that stage, he's my idol and I'm a fan and I know the story. And so I lived the album with him. So I think you have to take Captain Fantastic as a whole piece of work, really, and as an important thing for Elton to get his story off his chest. You know, trying to commit suicide, Someone Saved My Life Tonight, Tell Me When the Whistle Blows, you know, all those stories about how they got together and how it got to this point. Because can you imagine what it's like for a boy from Pinner to be the biggest rock star in the world? It is unbelievable. I mean, his life could never be the same. And I think he needed to make the statement for himself as much as anybody else. So that, I think, in viewed in that context, it's not goodbye Yellow Brick Road, but it's important for his sake to get the story told.
One of the upshots of the fact that, you know, Captain Fantastic hadn't really succeeded as people really hoped it had, that Elton more or less kind of ditched his band in 75. Nigel Olsen and Dee Murray, who'd been with him from the very early 70s, they both went. You know, Davy Johnson, who'd become the mainstay of the band, he remained. And Elton brought all these other people in, you know, I mean, a whole crew of guys. And basically with the idea of creating a rock and roll band, he said, I basically, you know, I've made pop records, I really want this next record, Rock of the Westies, to be a rock and roll affair.
They weren't really a rock band who grabbed you by the short and curlies. They're a kind of lame soft rock band, so it doesn't really work. And again, because he was so over prolific and, you know, churning them out without much quality control at all, it's one of the easily dismissed albums, and rightly so. Even the hit single from it, Island Girl, which is a sort of mock calypso Jamaica kind of thing, it wasn't that big a hit, and for Elton John to have a hit that wasn't that big a hit is some indication of how poor that album was.
For me, 1976's Blue Moves is actually, for me, one of the great underrated Elton John albums. I mean, not everything worked on Blue Moves, but I think it's a far more interesting work than history has accorded it.
This one really broke the dam, I think, because it was too much even for his fans. It was a double album that wouldn't even have hacked it as a single album if you'd pared it down and edited it. It had very little in the way of memorable songs. This is perhaps where the golden era, if there was one, of Elton John and Bernie Taupin ended.
Of course, I forget the one name that's also incredibly important in all of this is Gus Dudgeon. And Gus obviously produced Madman Across the Water, and he had his own studio out in Buckinghamshire, which is where we did A Single Man, and he called me up and asked me to work on another album. It didn't feel as groundbreaking. It felt like Elton, you know, by this point had moved on and didn't have the freshness. I don't wish to be negative, but the flower had bloomed and blown a little. You know, he still was obviously very talented, but then he was writing with Gary Osborne instead of Bernie Taupin. I can't write. Being a musician just called in to do a specific job. It would never be my role to actually make an observation about his general state. Not at the time, it wouldn't have even entered my head. But in retrospect, he did seem a little messed up by the razzmatazz of living in the sharp end of show business for the intervening years.
Well, it was after Blue Moves that sort of Taupin and Elton John basically, they went their separate ways. I think, you know, Taupin was in a bad state emotionally. Elton was disappearing into this kind of, you know, this spiral of sort of drink and drugs and general addiction. So Elton had made A Single Man in 1978, which is his first album without Taupin, and it flopped. And it was, I mean, he was writing at the time with a guy called Gary Osborne, that seemingly come from absolutely nowhere. Who was no Bernie Taupin as a lyricist. Elton sounded tired, he sounded jaded, and then basically what happened is that the albums got progressively worse. I mean, by the time of 1979's Victim of Love, which is one of the real low points of Elton's career, it was basically Elton goes disco at a time when, you know, to be honest, I mean, the whole disco thing had kind of gone. You know, and disco was more or less on its kind of last legs at that point. So Elton had got the timing all completely wrong. And I mean, Elton John goes disco is such a terrible idea anyway. The album flopped. It was clearly the start of a very, very, you know, sharp descent for him. And it would be years before he was reunited with Bernie Taupin. And then more and more years before he recaptured the form of the early to mid 70s. I think with 1983's Too Low for Zero, I think people misremember that album as a kind of, as Elton's great comeback. I mean, largely because you had I'm Still Standing, which was a huge hit, and I guess that's why they call it the blues, which really was kind of, I mean, that would have fitted onto something like Goodbye Yellow Brick Road, I think, in the 70s. But Elton was still in trouble. He had Bernie Taupin back on board again, but the two were not gelling as they used to. I mean, clearly, you know, I mean, Elton had problems, Bernie had problems. It wasn't a great working environment. So apart from the singles, he was proving that he could still occasionally turn out an unforgettable pop song that would sell. And Two Loaves of Zero sold by Elton's 80s standards. It was quite a success because I figured people heard the singles and thought, well, we'll have a whole album of this. Sadly, the album wasn't really up to scratch, and Elton was struggling. He was in big trouble. His career was in major downfall at this point.
Two Loaves of Zero was his comeback album, really, or to an extent. It brought him back from the dead, you know, creatively and commercially. Chiefly because he got back with Bernie Taupin, who wrote some half-decent lyrics that people could relate to. For all their clumsiness, Bernie Taupin does seem to be able to strike a chord and have the common touch. So I'm Still Standing was kind of, as well as an anthem that people could punch the air to and chirp gaily along to, it was a kind of a calling card from Elton John, an act of defiance to say, I'm still here. You know, punk rock may have been here, but I'm still going. Very corny, of course, but it worked. There hasn't been much of merit since then, and that's a long time ago now, if you think about it. Obviously, his biggest hit since then was the revisit to Candle in the Wind, when Princess Diana died and everyone got very over-emotional about someone they didn't know. But that was the biggest hit single of all time, I think, outselling White Christmas. So that's the landmark in his career since then. But there haven't been good albums, and he certainly isn't a decent rock artist worth respecting in terms of the creativity of his work. He's done some awfully cheesy stuff with The Lion King and things like that. And he's about as bland gets these days.
Throughout the 80s and 90s, there were times when Elton's kind of showbiz existence, his existence as a tabloid feature, was in serious danger, I think, of kind of eclipsing his music. People have pretty much given up on the idea of Elton John coming up with another great record. And suddenly he did it with 2001 Songs from the West Coast, which was a real kind of return to the kind of straightforward, simple writing and kind of, in a sense, production that, you know, had made albums like Goodbye Yellow Brick Road and the like. And basically, a real reminder that suddenly he was enjoying it again.
You know, it's real people playing real music, and you can tell the enthusiasm that he had for it again. And it was with Bernie. You know, I'm sure Gus would have been there somewhere if life had been different. But it was, again, going back to a roots place where the music was the most important thing. And I think that's always going to be difficult when you become a superstar entertainer, is that the thing that actually made you love it in the first place can actually get forgotten and lost.
The fact that they're musicians and songwriters, I think, is become only a factor in their presence on the scene. You know, they're socialites, they go to parties, they hang out with royalty and everything else. They've got a court. They go from mansion to mansion, and that's their life. You know, they occasionally knock out the occasional good tune, and maybe the odd occasional bad tune. But I don't think it's such a big factor in their life anymore.
Today, Elton John isn't really a rock act. He's kind of a national institution, like the Queen Mother was or something. He's dearly beloved just because we all know all the elements about his private life and so on. He's the sort of fairy godfather of up-and-coming pop acts. And when I say pop, I do mean pop. The people he duets with are kind of blue and, you know, middle-of-the-road kind of boy bands, this kind of thing. Nothing too challenging or threatening. If he's not careful, or it may be too late already, no one will remember the music he made. They'll just remember this kind of slightly silly, cartoonish celebrity. And it would be a shame, because there were some good records in the 70s, not as many as I think he's generally, you know, praised for. He wasn't ever that good, but if he's not careful, it'll be so long since he made a half-decent record that people will forget the good ones he did make.
There's a lot of confusion about, well, is he a singer-songwriter? You know, is he a pop artist? Is he trying to do soul? You know, and really, you know, when Elton was starting off, he was doing a bit of everything. And I think around the time of Goodbye Yellow Brick Road, it suddenly dawned on people that basically Elton John, love him or loathe him, but he was more or less his own genre. Basically, Elton John was almost like a category you could have in a shop. You'd have pop, you'd have rock, you'd have rockabilly, you'd have Elton John. He's a bit of pop, and he's a bit of rock, and, you know, he does the odd bit of kind of pastiche rock and roll, and, you know, some of his stuff, you know, kind of with a nod to Philly soul, country, pretty much the whole lot.
He's been incredibly successful, and already the songs are lasting 30 years. Now, that's a good indicator, isn't it? I think he was incredibly talented. And still is, and has a wonderful ear for melody. I think he's surrounded himself with really good people, and sometimes the fates just push the thing in the right direction, and it happens. I wouldn't be surprised if he was a genius. Maybe too early to tell.